every single thing that you've gone through equips you to be able to do what you were born to do.
Welcome back to another Find Your Purpose Now podcast. So I have been doing a series on questions that we can ask ourselves throughout our lives. I mean, over and over and over again. Your answers are going to be different when you're 30 as opposed to when you were 15 or when you're 50 or whenever. So I'm going to jump right back in where we left off. So think about what your favorite talents or skills or abilities are that you have. This is not about being arrogant or show off or anything like that. They're just, I mean, the reality is there are things that you do really, really well. So what do you like about yourself when it comes to what you're able to do? So I'll give you my example. I like that I just kind of have a natural tendency to find good things about other people and comment on them. And it's not about just empty compliments. It's really about just reminding people how awesome they are, but not in kind of a, you know, generic way where it really doesn't mean that much. You know, if somebody says, oh my gosh, you're the greatest. Okay. You know, maybe it doesn't mean that much. But if you say specifically, you're so good at making everybody feel welcomed and included. And, you know, so you see what I'm saying? When you say what the specifics are that you really like about somebody, then it's really meaningful because it's not the same compliment you give to everybody. When somebody says something about you that, or what you can do, one of your talents, one of your abilities or skills, it really resonates. It hits home because you know when you're good at something. So really think about what of your particular abilities do you like about yourself? Okay, the next one. And I think this is actually number 14 in the series. What were your nicknames as a child, as a teenager, as a young adult? What nicknames have you had? What names have people put on you? Now, some of these things might be kind of negative or might bring up some bad memories. You know, if that's the case, forget it. That was then, this is now, it's no longer relevant. But the reason that I included this question here is that there may have been a nickname or something like that when you were a child that may prompt a memory in your mind about something that you did well, something that you were known for, that just came naturally to you. An example would be, let's say you played softball as a kid and, you know, teammates or the coach or somebody called you Slugger. Okay, well, you know, are you somebody who as a kid you threw your whole body into, you know, trying to make that bat hit that ball? A lot of times those things have some real truth in them, have some real substance in them, and can be extrapolated out to today. So if you were somebody who, I don't know, let's say you were really good on the piano, or you were really good at picking up, you know, other languages, or you were really good at paying attention to how other people felt and had an extraordinary amount of empathy for a child or whatever, that could be a real indicator of who you really are, your authentic personality. Again, if there's negativity, you know, it was probably somebody who, you know, put that on you, who really didn't know you. Maybe they weren't in their right mind. Maybe they didn't see the amazingness of you. So forget it and move on. But pull out those little nuggets of gold where you can find them. Okay, number 15. What should your nickname be now? And again, positive only. So think about the things that you're known for, the things that you love to do. And you know what? You can pick your own identifiers. You can choose your own nickname. You can choose your own adjectives that you want to use to describe yourself. And you can get rid of all the ones that no longer apply to you, that no longer serve you. And if this is not making any sense, let me just tell you that, you know, in different seasons of our lives, there are different words that describe us. The words that we use to describe us go straight to our self-esteem, straight to our self-respect, straight to the amount of dignity that we have or don't. So let me give you an example. When I was a kid, there was a period of time when I was homeless, 8 years old in the second grade. And so I always, even beyond that time, I mean, we still lived in a raggedy shack. And, you know, even when we weren't homeless, it wasn't great. But I always had that thing in my head. And it prompted me to want to buy my first house. You know, I didn't have furniture. I didn't have a refrigerator at first. I mean, it was more important to me to have the house than to have all the stuff that goes in it. I thought, okay, well, if I can figure out how to get the house, then eventually I can figure out how to put stuff in it. But it was important for me to have my space, my safe place. I wanted to go from homeless to homeowner. I wanted to go from tenant to homeowner. I wanted to go from being an employee to being an employer. I wanted to go from being abrasive to being kind. I wanted to go from being angry to peaceful and joyful. You see where I'm going with this. So maybe it's not whatever nickname you want now, but think about what words you want to use to describe who you are now at this place in your life. Okay. Number 16. Oh, this is an interesting one. What do you daydream about? What are your daydreams? Maybe you could say, what are your goals? What do you think about? If you could buy anything, have anything, do anything, go anywhere, what would those things be? They might be indicators for you of your purpose. And because there are desires that are woven into us, things that we want to do, enjoy doing, that, you know, they give us joy, they give us peace. And since we know that peace and joy always accompany living in our purpose, sometimes the way we can find our purpose is to follow our peace, follow our joy. I think that's part of how I wound up becoming an author. I mean, my first book was really a letter to somebody. It was the longest letter ever in the history of humanity. but I never intended to become an author. But now after 15 books, and I think there are probably more books inside of me, but I think it's connected somehow that I've always loved to read. My peaceful place, my happy place, my very relaxed place is when I'm reading a book. So it's just not that much of a stretch to go from reading to writing, to sharing what I know for sure. And we all have that. We all have our story. We all have the things that we know for sure, the things that we've learned along the way. I'm getting off on the tangent because I think for some of us, part of our purpose is writing. Maybe writing your own book. If you want to consider doing that, if you want some help doing that, and that's not for everybody. I don't mean to imply that it is. It certainly is not. But if you do want to write a book and you're interested in doing that and you'd like some help, I actually put together an online course. I've done in-person immersion retreats, three-day retreats, where you leave, you know, with your book or at least your first draft of your book. And then, you know, I quit doing that during COVID, obviously, and kind of cleared the decks and spent months. I think it took me about 9 months to create this course. So you can find it on my website, Rhonda, R-H-O-N-D-A.org, if you're interested. Okay, the next one, 17. What heroic feats have you performed? Think about that. And, you know, it doesn't have to be something that made the papers. It doesn't have to be something where the news vans rolled up. But maybe they did. I mean, have you helped somebody who was in a car accident? Have you helped a child, you know, avoid getting hit by a car? I mean, whatever it is, think about the heroic feats that you've performed. This is relevant to your purpose because it can give you insights, again, to who you are, to your authentic identity, to how well you pay attention to your surroundings, for example, the level of empathy that you have for others, the point at which you're willing to intervene on behalf of someone else. It doesn't have to be a physical thing. It can be you standing up for somebody when, you know, somebody's talking trash about somebody you know, and you stand up and say, wait a minute, that's not true. Or that's an unkind thing to say. You don't know that for sure, or whatever. Sometimes it's just a matter of us having the courage or having had the courage in the past to stand up and say, I don't think that's right. And when a whole entire group of people is talking a certain way, thinking a certain way, and you're the one lone person in the crowd who stands up and says, I don't think that joke is appropriate, or I don't want to be involved in this. So, you know, have a great day. I'm out of here. Whatever it is, that could be a heroic feat, but think about what you've done in that regard and what it says about you. What does it say about your character, about who you are, about your likes and your dislikes? It all goes into this masterpiece that's you. Okay. Number 18. What quality have you most improved in your life? Up to this point, what quality have you most improved? I can say that for me, I think that I was really, really difficult. There are a lot of people right now who know me that, you know, if they're listening, they're like, yeah, I can attest to that. So, I think for me, it was just, you know, sort of the undercurrent of anger that I had as a result of abuse in my life when I was younger. And it didn't take very much to scratch the surface and the volcano of anger would explode. And I think I've improved a great deal. Well, first of all, I no longer walk around angry. So that's a huge improvement right there. And I think I treat people better than I did before. And I think it's because I'm just more capable of doing that. It's not that I wanted to mistreat anybody. As a matter of fact, when my anger would erupt, I would feel terribly about it. Well, it wasn't bad enough that I was walking around with this, you know, pot of boiling anger inside of me all the time. But then when it splashed on somebody else and my anger made somebody else feel badly, then I felt even worse. It just never, whatever negative emotions are inside of you, you know, nothing good can come from that, from having those emotions eat you up inside, harm the people closest to you. It's not good. So that's what I've improved the most on. If you need improvement in that area of anger, or it can be any other negative emotion, jealousy, envy, you know, anything that steals your joy, by all means, do everything you can to improve on that. For me, it was a very faith-filled journey. It was really kind of a miraculous thing that God just helped me, like, open up the release valve on that anger and let it just flow out of me. But whatever you've done to improve, I don't know, you might've gone back to school and learned a new trade or got another degree or whatever is your situation. Anytime we learn something, it's an improvement. We can have an insight about ourselves. It doesn't have to be some, you know, I went back to school and took years and, you know, now I have this piece of paper. It doesn't, you know, it can be just something personal that, that you've worked on and you feel better about now. Think about that, because again, it's an indicator of who you are and how far you've come. And when you start stepping back through whatever it was that needed improvement before, you can follow that path to your purpose or something having to do with your purpose. It's all part of the experience train that you've been writing your whole entire life. Your purpose, there are so many clues to your purpose. I like to say on that experience train, and I like to say that your purpose can be found in the broken pieces of the painful events of your life. So, you know, if some of this work kind of scrapes the scab off of a wound, and I mean, none of us wants that. None of us wants to deal with it. We didn't want to go through it the first time. We certainly don't want to, you know, relive it again. But I can tell you that for me anyway, when I did that, when I had the courage and I was at a place in my life when I could do this without resurrecting the whole thing and having to relive it, it was really productive for me. It helped me to come up and to a higher place and be able to look at the situation with a different perspective, with a more mature point of view from the place I'm in now, instead of when I was living in it and trying to process it. You don't have perspective. You don't have context. And so looking back at it long enough to mine the lessons out of it, it's so key. Okay, let's do one more today. So what things do you say regularly? And what would you like to be known for saying? Ooh, kind of loaded. It's loaded for me anyway. Because, you know, most of us tend to say things that family members said. You know, we hear things coming out of our own mouths that somebody who was a great influence in our life said. And when I say great influence, I don't mean necessarily great, fabulous influence. Maybe it was not a great influence, not a good influence at all. I used to say things that were sort of just phrases that the people who raised me said. It was totally normal. And an example would be, you know, a kid going to school, first grader, second grader, who's using foul language, and they think that it's totally normal. Well, if that's what they hear at home, and, you know, for the first word to be the F word or whatever, and everybody fell out laughing and they thought it was so cute, so they teach the toddler the wrong words, it's normal for that kid to grow up and use that language. Okay, so that's an extreme example. But, you know, if you, whatever the situation was that you grew up in, you may have brought some of that language with you. Really think about the things you say, the things that come out of your mouth. And then ask yourself, do you really want to be known for that? Do you want to be known for saying that? If you do, great. You know, if it's funny, it's entertaining, it's positive, it's uplifting, you know, makes everybody feel good, great. If not, consider scratching that phrase or word from your vocabulary I had to do this. And I had to practice. I don't have to do it anymore. It just comes naturally. But for a long time, I had to practice slowing down and not just saying the first thing that came to my mind. I felt like intentionally install a filter so that everything that popped into my head didn't just fall out of my mouth. And so in order to install the filter, I asked myself, how would I feel if somebody said this to me? What is the expectation? What do I think other people are going to feel like if I say this to them or within their earshot? Is this a good thing? Is it a positive thing? Is it a critical thing? Does it need to be said at all? And you can do, if that's you, if you're like I was, and your thoughts become verbal before they're really, you know, all the way baked. I mean, I still have an issue with that. Oh, I think I might always have an issue with that, but I'm better than I used to be. And I try to be really deliberate about my choice of words, because I want to be known for being positive, encouraging, empowering. I want to be helpful. I want to leave people better off than I found them. Every person, the checker in the grocery store, the bank teller, the person I pass on the way, you know, walking in and out of the store, wherever it is, I think our kindness and our authentic personality should not be reserved for only the people closest to us or only the people who we let in to the walls of our lives. The more we let our real, authentic, good personality out, the more we share it with people who are maybe not right in our inner circle, but further out and further out and further out. The further out we go, the brighter our light shines. And maybe that is part of our purpose. Sharing the good that's in us. In our facial expressions, our gestures, our eye contact, our attitude. People can see your attitude, by the way. Your body language, your words, and ultimately your behaviors. Your words and your behaviors are informed by your attitude. So, to the degree that you can intentionally put on a good attitude, you'll have a much better chance of letting your light shine in all of those ways that I just mentioned, to the broadest number of people. And when you do that, you improve, you sort of clear the path to your purpose. Because somebody somewhere needs you. They need what you're able to do. They want you to be their employee. They want you to be their business partner. They want you to be their friend. They want you to be their partner for life. Our people are out there. So when you answer all these questions and really get clear on who you are today, get rid of the things that no longer fit with that. Keep the things that really help you shine. You will ultimately walk right straight into your purpose. All right, see you next time.
The things that you've been through have changed the way you see the world. They've qualified you to do what you were born to do and perfectly matched to do. Is there anything more important than finding and living the purpose for which you were born? I don't think so. I think that's the point.